penetrating FCC structure. I tell you all the lattice parameters and so on. Is that sufficient to understand the properties of diamond?
I think no, sir, because the interaction, we have to identify the nature of interactions also between two atoms.
Okay. So which means you have to identify the nature of bonding, right? And how, what yes. kind of a band structure that gives rise to, right? And what are the degrees of freedom? So if there are electrons in the bands, then how strongly do they interact with each other? Then what is the strength of the bond? Right? So all of those things are also important in order to determine the property, right? But determining the structure is very important, because knowing the structure, one can talk about the specifics of that material. Okay? So the diamond structure itself is a very important, You can send him the link. Not able to join. So shall I just send in the link? Would that be okay? Right. Just give me 1 second. Yeah, hopefully with this he will be able to join. And I think I have not told you something, but the TA for this course is Vinayak Kulkarni, my PhD student. So, he is also there in this group. So you can write to him. I think his email is vmkphykulkarni. Okay. Yeah. So, I think he will probably try to join now. Let me see. I don't see him yet. Okay, let me see. If he tries to join and still is not able to join, we'll see. Okay. structure property relationship. And we were saying that if we take diamond, for example, then the hardness of diamond is directly related to its structure. And if we take the property of, let's say, graphite, where the layers can slide over each other, then it's directly related to the van der Waals interaction between the layers, and also to this layered structure of graphite. So the structure is indeed very important. We talked about emergence in the first lecture, right? And it turns out that if you think about it, the properties of a crystal, or a crystal itself, is an emergent object. Okay, so a crystal is itself an example of emergence. And how is it? I mean, if you think about the constituents would be like atoms or molecules. And if you take individual atoms or molecules, then their properties would be very different. If some of you are interested, you can actually take a look at this term in more detail. Okay, emergence is actually a very deep philosophical concept. And there are various kinds of emergence. I would suggest you can take a look at it. There are people who work specifically on this philosophical concept. So, but for us in this course, if you take the constituents as atoms or molecules, I think now he's trying to join. Yeah, Gautamish. So, if you take the properties of individual atoms or molecules, then it's not apparent how the properties of a crystal emerge. Okay, so carbon atoms, as we discussed just now, if they arrange themselves in the graphite structure or the diamond structure, the properties that emerge from that, even though the constituents are exactly the same, the properties that emerge could be very widely different. Okay, so a crystal itself is an emergent concept. Now, one more thing is that we know that it also depends on the formation of a crystal, also depends on the kind of bonding. Okay, and the bonding could be of various types. It could be ionic bonding, there could be covalent bonding, there could be hydrogen bonding, there could be polar covalent, there could be van der Waals. And there are so many different kinds of bondings that far better than to the first. Okay, so now we will go into some details of the classes of crystals, but not into the bonding. Okay, so let me tell you about one more concept, which is related to the breaking of symmetries. So let me save this, save a copy. Okay. Okay, so what I want to discuss in little bit of detail is the following. If I take a gas, okay, and then cool it, I get a liquid. And if I take a liquid and cool it, I get a solid. So that's something that we all understand. There are many examples of these kinds of phase transitions. Okay. So if we go in this direction, we are obviously changing the symmetry of the system, right? So if I take a gas, for example, I have, or even a liquid, what we can see is that there is Galilean is preserved in the form of translations and rotations, okay? So continuous rotations and continuous translations. So which means I can translate my origin to a different point and the system looks exactly the same. I can rotate my frame of reference and again the system looks exactly the same, right? Now, this is not true when I reach the solid phase, okay? So this continuous symmetry is actually broken. So continuous symmetry is broken. And breaking of a continuous symmetry is very important because it leads to something called Nambu-Goldstone modes. Okay. So what are examples of these? Okay, so what I'm saying is that once you break a certain continuous symmetry, then there are certain modes in the system that arise. Now let me first say why the continuous symmetry is broken. So in a solid, if I consider a crystal where there is a periodic arrangement of atoms or molecules, then you can see that the crystal will look exactly the same only when I make a translation, okay, by a discrete amount, right? So discrete translational symmetry is still preserved. So instead of a continuous translational symmetry, I get a discrete translational symmetry. And similarly, there will be a discrete rotational symmetry, discrete translational plus rotational symmetry. So the transformation or the transition from the breaking of a continuous rotation and translational symmetry into a discrete translational rotational symmetry, this is one example of something called spontaneous symmetry breaking. So the system has broken symmetry spontaneously. And when this kind of spontaneous symmetry breaking happens, okay, especially if there is a continuous symmetry that is broken, then you get long wavelength or zero energy Goldstone modes, Nambu-Goldstone modes. And an example of this, especially in the case of crystals, are basically phonons. Okay, so phonons are actually a result of the breaking of the continuous symmetry. One more thing that happens if you preserve a symmetry is the conservation of some quantity, right? So all of you know that if I preserve a continuous translational symmetry, right? So translational symmetry, if it is conserved, then if it is preserved, then momentum is conserved. So what is this theorem called? Which tells you that the a certain symmetry is related to certain conservation. Yeah, Noether's theorem. So, by the so who answered this?
Purnendu.
May I know your name?
Sir Purnendu.
Punindu, yeah. Punindu was, no, is there a man or a woman?
I don't know, sir.
He was a
guess?
Woman.
Guess, guess.
It was a woman.
Yeah, Emma Noether is a woman, okay? A very important mathematician. All right, okay. So this theorem tells you that the preservation of some symmetry leads to conservation of a quantity, of a physical quantity. So conservation of momentum, consequence of preservation of translational symmetry. So if I break this continuous symmetry, does it mean that momentum is no longer conserved? It was a question. So in when the gas transforms to a solid, continuous translational symmetry has been broken. Okay? So if a continuous translational symmetry has been broken, it means continuous momentum is no longer preserved. The momentum is no longer, I'm not, sorry, preserved, but it's not conserved. So what happens to conservation of momentum then in a crystal?
So there are many forms of phonons generated, like lattice vibration, and total momentum of the total system is conserved.
So if the total momentum is conserved, right, then there should be continuous translation symmetry also, right?
Sir, it's the crystal momentum which is conserved here.
Correct. And the when we go to the reciprocal lattice, we will see that momentum is conserved up to a reciprocal lattice vector.
Yes.
So it's modulo a reciprocal lattice vector, which means if you add a reciprocal lattice vector, okay, nothing changes.
Yes.
Right? So which means that exact momentum is not conserved. Right? You can add
yes.
reciprocal lattice vectors to the momentum and still you will find momentum is conserved. Right? So that's a very important consequence. Okay? So momentum is conserved, but up to certain discrete reciprocal lattice vectors. Okay? And the emergence of phonons, okay, is a result of breaking of this continuous symmetry. And phonons, as you know, are low energy. So if you take acoustic phonons, then they are long wavelength, which means zero energy, okay, zero energy Goldstone modes. And this is something that is again not taught exactly in crystallography, but this is important to understand, you know, all these. It's important to understand all these concepts because these are all related, okay? And one should view crystal as an emergent concept. One should view the crystal as the as a spontaneous symmetry breaking example. And once a spontaneous symmetry breaks, then what are the kind of things that happen? Okay? That the reciprocal lattice emerges, right? And then you see Nambu Goldstone modes in the form of phonons. So acoustic and transverse phonons and so on. Okay. So this is something that I wanted to mention. Now we can go slightly deeper into what is crystal structure itself. Okay. So let me save this. All right. Okay. So before we go into the concepts of a crystal, let me ask you the following. What are the kinds of crystals that we know of? I'm not talking about FCC, BCC and so on. So FCC, BCC, these are all classes of crystals. Okay. So if I take arrangements of atoms and molecules, then they form into certain classes. So we know of these. Okay. So these are what I would call regular crystals, which are studied within crystallography. What are some unusual crystals that you know?
Are you talking about quasi-crystal
like substances? Good. Okay. Quasi-crystals is something. Yes. Anything else?
So there is something called liquid crystal, but I don't know how it is.
Yes, liquid crystals. So only on the application of a field, they assume a crystalline form. Molecules are arranged in a liquid-like manner. They can move, they have full rotational degrees of freedom and so on, but as soon as you apply a field, these things align in some direction, and that is used to form LCDs, liquid crystal displays. Okay, so liquid crystals is another example. Anything else?
Perovskite structures.
Yes, I would say perovskite structures are also a part of regular crystallography. Right?
Okay.
Anything else? Have you heard of something called time crystals? And there is a concept now called choreographic crystals, which is related to the time crystals. So the idea is that this was proposed by an MIT physicist called Franz Wilczek. This is his name. He's a Nobel laureate. He proposed that you can also break continuous time translational symmetry. Okay? And what you would get is a time crystal. So these things would be spatially crystalline, but not always. Yes, as a function of time, things keep changing, but periodically you would see the crystalline form, right? And what Franz Wilczek proposed was in an isolated quantum system, but it was there was a huge debate that followed after his proposal. There were two groups which immediately showed that there is a possibility of this time crystals in, so you just read about it, there is a ring of ions that somebody created, and they claimed that upon driving the system with a periodic drive, what happened was that the system had a natural frequency which was half of the driving frequency. Okay? It was a subharmonic, right? And the emergence of a subharmonic mode in a crystal, a smoking gun signature of a time crystal. Okay, so this was this is one of the latest discoveries, right? Time crystals, and now it is known that you cannot have a time crystal in equilibrium, okay, without driving the system, if you have only short-range interactions. However, it has been also shown that you can have an isolated quantum system with very long-range interactions, and there you don't need to drive the system. Okay, without driving the system, you can have a time crystal, right? So that's a very interesting concept. Research is still going on in this aspect, but that's there. And then this has also been proposed by a person who is studying satellites. Okay, so there is a PRL paper which talks about choreographic crystals. And this arose in the context of satellites. Okay, so a person wants to place the satellites in the Earth's atmosphere in such a way that they have a regular arrangement, but it's a dancing arrangement. Okay, so choreograph is basically dance, right? So you want to choreograph their movement in such a way that they assume regular crystalline structures at regular periods. So that has been also proposed, and it's a PRL paper. It's a very interesting concept. Any other crystals?
Excuse me, sir. Sir, I have a question. Yes. Sir, we can say then time crystal is a state of matter that repeats after some time and periodically after some time, and also as well as in space also.
That's the understanding, yes.
Okay.
Correct. If you take a regular crystal, right, it is the same at all times. Correct?
Correct, correct.
So, but a time crystal is not the same as a function of time.
Okay. And what will happen if discrete time symmetry will be broken?
No, then continuous time symmetry is broken. You're opening a Pandora's box now, okay? You can associate two symmetries with time. One is translational symmetry, okay, and one is called reversal, time reversal symmetry. Okay, so let me not go into this. Maybe this will come later when we introduce the magnetic field. But time translational symmetry just says that the laws of physics remain the same no matter if you do your experiment today or tomorrow. Constants of physics, the laws of physics will remain the same. But if a continuous time and continuous time translational symmetry is associated, according to Noether's theorem, with energy conservation. Okay, so the point is that if you are breaking a continuous time translational symmetry, then there should be a violation of energy conservation. And this is the reason why most people argued that you cannot have isolated time crystals. Okay, so isolated time crystals are impossible. Okay? These are impossible. The reason it's impossible is because if the energy is not conserved for a time crystal, then you cannot isolate it. Somehow the energy has to be pumped in and it has to be pumped out. Okay, so you can only have a steady state time crystal. You cannot have isolated time crystal. Okay, which means that it's not an equilibrium concept. It's a truly non-equilibrium concept. Okay? But you can have something in the steady state. Right. So, yeah. Any other form of crystals? So I read something about chiral crystals. I don't know what they are, but there is something called chiral crystals. Okay. So, have you all heard about spin crystals? Spin crystals. Yes, no?
No, no.
No? Anyone has heard?
No.
Any yes?
I've heard.
Yes, about what are spin crystals?
Sir, actually I don't know much about this.
Okay, in what context did you hear about them? Okay, so let me explain them. So normal magnets, if I take a magnet, any magnet, okay, which has a permanent magnetization, would be a spin crystal, right? So any magnet which has long range order, for example, a ferromagnet. A ferromagnet has spins aligned along a single direction placed periodically. So that's a spin crystal. A ferromagnet is also an example of a spin crystal. An antiferromagnet is also an example of a spin crystal. Isn't that right? So if you take antiferromagnet, so if I take a ferromagnet, for example, then all the spins are placed in a periodic arrangement. So that's so the unit cell for this crystal is basically one single spin. Now, if I take a ferromagnet, then I can again draw a unit cell composed of two spins. And this again becomes a spin crystal. If I take an antiferromagnet like this, again I can double the unit cell and this becomes a spin crystal. Okay. There are also materials called spin ice. Okay. And this is an interesting form of crystal where it's called spin ice because the ice rule is followed. And if you see the way ice is arranged, the water molecules are arranged, there is something called a two-in, two-out rule. Okay, so there is something called a two-in, two-out rule. Just Google it. Okay, so ice two-in, two-out rule. And it turns out that in the spin ice material also, the spins are arranged in such a way that two spins are pointing inwards and two spins are pointing outwards. And in these spin ice materials, it has also been shown that you can have a monopole-like structure. Remember, in magnetism, if you take pure magnets, you can never separate a dipole. You cannot get a pure north pole or a pure south pole, right? But it turns out in spin ice materials, you can have a monopole-like structure. Okay? So this is a very interesting structure. Then there are something called spin textures. And these
sir, in that case, there is this magnetic skirmion crystals also, right?
Exactly, exactly. That's what I was going to come to. That is a part of spin textures. So skirmions. Third in fractional quantum Hall systems. Okay. So spin crystals is one another example. So let me save this and then move on to some other crystals. Okay, meanwhile, think about more kinds of crystals. So this has given you a hint, right? Think of a degree of freedom and put that in a periodic arrangement. That gives you a crystal, right? So think of some other degree of freedom. Can I place the charge in a crystalline form? So it's called CDW, SDW. This stands for charge density wave, spin density wave. What about electron crystals? Have you heard of electron crystals? Anyone? Do you think electrons can form crystals? Indeed, they do. Okay. So let me take an example. So we know that water can exist in three forms. I mean, this is a very simplistic picture. So steam, then liquid water, and ice. Okay. But actually, water is still not understood. Okay, and if you want to know more about water, then I would suggest you read some papers by Srikant Shastri, who has worked on water, and there are still unknown phases of water. Okay, so there are so many phase transitions that water goes through, even within ice. In the same way as water assumes these three forms, electrons also have these three forms. Okay, so what is an electron gas called? What is an electron gas called? It's a Fermi gas. Have you all not studied Fermi gas in solid state physics? The gas of electrons, a free electron gas?
Yes, sir.
Right?
Yes, sir.
So, when we say it's a free electron gas, what we mean is that these electrons are not interacting with each other at all. These are non-interacting electrons moving completely independently of each other. The only way they interact, is through the Pauli's exclusion principle. Apart from that, we assume when we describe a Fermi gas that they don't repel each other at all. Correct? Okay. So this is an example of an electron gas. As it happens within water, that if you cool the system, then the water molecules start interacting with each other, okay, and they start forming hydrogen bonds. So here also, the electrons start forming a liquid. And this liquid is called a Fermi liquid. Okay? So if you start bringing in interactions, then you get something called a Fermi liquid. If you make the interactions even stronger, right, you get a solid, you get an electron solid or an electron crystal, right? And there are many different forms in which this happens. A Wigner crystal. And a Wigner crystal is basically supposed to be a gas of electrons where the density is so low, the density of electrons is really low. And because the density of electrons is very, very low, the potential energy actually dominates. Okay? It's a very counterintuitive concept. You might think that if I pack electrons very densely in a solid, then the electrons should repel each other very strongly. Yeah.
To go from the Fermi gas to Fermi liquid, do we have to change the temperature of the system or something like that?
Yes. So you can do various things. So there are, you can have a transition, for example, through doping, through pressure, through many other parameters from a Fermi gas to a Fermi liquid. And there are systems which naturally occur in a Fermi gas form. For example, if you think of copper or gold or these excellent metals, for example, then a Fermi gas description works really well. Okay? And if you think of slightly more complicated materials, like for example, if I cool the, if I take a compound, for example, like, you know, some transition metal oxide, okay, then you would see there that even though it's a metal, good metal, okay, it's not like I can describe the system using completely non-interacting electrons. Okay? I would have to incorporate the interactions between electrons, only weak interactions, and through these weak interactions, the system behaves like a Fermi liquid. Okay? But then there are other systems where the electrons, the interactions are so strong that the electrons get localized. Okay? So the when you have completely localized electrons, okay, then you can have things called Mott insulators. And there are many materials which are also examples of Mott insulators, right? But again, Mott insulators are systems where the charge is completely localized, charge is localized, okay? But you can have spins which are still free. So in terms of the insulator, it's only a charge insulator, not be an insulator. Okay. So this is called quantum spin liquid, a kind of a liquid. So just before, for example, a magnet, I told you, was an example of a crystal, right? It was an example of a spin crystal because the spins are arranged in a perfectly periodic arrangement. But what if the spins were free to rotate and move, okay, and free to propagate? Now, how does spin propagate without charge being propagating? So that's again a new concept, and there are things, there's a phenomenon called spin charge separation in condensed matter physics where the spin can propagate independently of the charge, okay? And that gives rise to concepts called quantum spin liquids, right? So let me not go into that. I was telling you that this is another point.
So the voice is not clear.
Okay. Is it not clear to everyone? Maybe the network is fluctuating, so is it clear now?
Now it's clear.
Okay. Yeah, I think the network is... Yeah. Yes. Okay. Yeah, so the Wigner crystal happens in a system where the lattice is not important. Lattice is not important. What I mean by this is that... underlying lattice, okay, so the underlying lattice, for example, could have a spacing, a lattice spacing of maybe a few angstroms, okay. So, but then this Wigner crystal, where the electrons are sitting in definite positions, okay, this could be a very different crystal from the underlying crystal, which is like this. It could be a completely different lattice parameter. Do you see what I'm saying? That the underlying lattice has a certain structure, okay? And the Wigner crystal, which is purely electrons, these dots that you see, they have assumed a crystalline form which is entirely different from that which is the underlying lattice. Yeah. So that happens when you have a electron gas, but you tune the density. So, and that has been shown to work in some materials. So Wigner crystal has not been conclusively demonstrated experimentally. There are debates that whether the phenomenon found was really a Wigner crystal or not. But there are certain reports. Okay, and what they have done there is that if you manage somehow to reduce the screening between electrons. See, electrons are screened by each other as well as by the positive ion background that is present in a solid. But if you manage to somehow reduce that screening between the electrons so that the repulsion between electrons is almost like the repulsion that they feel in vacuum, then you can see the formation of this Wigner crystal. And that can happen, for example, on surfaces. See, on a surface, you don't have that kind of a 3D screening mechanism that you would have inside a solid. Okay, so I would suggest you go into the literature and find out what are the systems where Wigner crystal has been found. But let me then tell you the difference between the Wigner crystal and a Mott insulator. So in a Mott insulator, for example, you can take a material like V2O3. Okay? So V2O3 turns out that it has partially filled d orbitals. And it's a proper periodic structure. Okay. So what happens is that in the Mott insulating phase of this material, the electrons get localized on the d orbitals. Okay? And they don't move at all. Right? So the electrons get localized, but then if you apply pressure to this material, it turns out that there is an insulator to metal transition. Electrons which were localized and behaved like a crystal, behaved like an electron solid, if you apply pressure, the electrons become a liquid, okay, by application of pressure. So it goes from an electron solid, which is a Mott insulator, which has the same periodicity as that of the underlying lattice. It goes into, the electron system goes into a liquid phase, which is a metallic phase. Okay. So is the difference clear now between the Wigner crystal and Mott insulator? Yeah. So yeah, electron crystals or electronic properties are a very important thing, and we will come to that. But I just wanted to emphasize that there are internal degrees of freedom of a solid which can have their own life, okay? Which can assume crystalline form, liquid form, gaseous form, and so on, which are somehow disconnected from the background, from the positive ion background. Okay. Any other crystals?
Sir, I'm Krishna.
Sorry?
Sir, there was some internet issue. I could not hear what are Wigner crystals. Can
okay.
you repeat it?
Yeah, sure. So I was saying that the Wigner crystal is basically when you have, let me just bring up an image maybe. That's probably clearer. Let me show you.
So there is no option to recording on Google Meet, right?
There is. I just did not record. I could have recorded. Okay. Maybe we will record.
Yes, sir.
So if you see here, see this is, for example, can you see the image here? Yeah?
Yeah.
So these things are probably electrons, you know, these electrons have assumed a certain crystalline form, which is independent of the underlying solid state crystal. So let's say you have a solid mm-hmm. state crystal, in that there are free electrons. The parameters or the density of electrons in such a way, you dope the system, okay? And you dope the system mm-hmm. in such a way that you reduce the density of electrons, you would see a Wigner crystal forming. So one, I think it has been seen in 2D electron gases, in MOSFETs and so on, where quantum Hall has been seen. There you can see this because by tuning the gate voltage, you can tune the electron density very easily. And by tuning the electron density, making it higher to lower, you can go from an electron gas-like system to an electron liquid to an electron solid. Okay?
Okay.
So do read more about it, right? And then come back to me with more questions. Okay? Look at the difference. Where has it been found, for example? You can tell us all about it. Okay, where has Wigner crystal been found? What is the debate that is going on? And Mott insulators are a very well-studied subject, right? There it is well known how electrons get localized because of electron-electron interactions. Okay. Another difference between these two is that the interactions here, the electron interactions here are long range. Okay? But in the Mott insulators, the electron-electron interactions are extremely short ranged. That's one very very important example. I had forgotten to mention that.
Okay.
Yeah. So while I save this, why don't you tell me? Any other example of a crystal? Any other crystal?
Does not come to my mind what any other possibility can be.
Have you heard of DNA crystals?
No.
Have you heard of protein crystals?
Yeah, protein crystals I have heard.
Viruses?
No.
So it turns out you can actually make very nice structures using DNA. You can crystallize protein, you can crystallize viruses. Right? So what is the difference between these kind of crystals and the crystals that we usually study in solid state?
They are biomolecules.
They are biomolecules, yes. So one thing is that you would find a periodic arrangement. That is true, right? That is why it's called a crystal. It's a periodic arrangement.
So the repeating unit will be too large.
But exactly, yeah. So the repeat unit or the unit cell is going to be a very large molecule. Very large entity, I would say.
Okay.
Right?
Mm-hmm.
And it could be a whole protein, it could be a whole virus, and so on. similar kind of things are also made in, not similar, but I would say different class of materials called metal organic frameworks, which are studied within JNC. Metal organic frameworks, as the name suggests, you can have a hybrid thing, metal and organic. So you have a framework of these, right? So this is useful, for example, in phenomena like hydrogen storage, where you want to store hydrogen and also you want to release it. And you can have polymeric crystals, where again the repeating entity is a polymer. So you can have either a small molecule crystal or a large molecule crystal. Okay, so there are nanocrystals also, and nanocrystals I would say are slightly different from bulk crystals, because the structure that you would have inside a nanocrystal, even though the material is the same, is not the same as the bulk form. For example, if I take gold, then gold in its nano form does not have the same structure as the bulk form. Yeah, and that's the reason why you can see different colors and so on. Okay? So nanocrystals also, I would say, are a different class in themselves. Well, that's all I can think of. If you think of anything else, do let me know. There are things called photonic crystals and so on, but have you heard of photonic crystals? So the idea is, in photonic crystals, like in a regular crystal, you have atoms in a periodic arrangement, right? So you have atoms in a, this is in a regular crystal, you have atoms in a periodic arrangement. I'm sorry, I'm writing on this slate and the handwriting that I'm seeing here, my own handwriting, I'm a little bit embarrassed about it. I don't write so bad, okay? On the board, you will see I write slightly better. So in a regular crystal, atoms are in a periodic arrangement, but in a photonic crystal, the periodic arrangement is not about the atoms themselves. It's a dielectric function. So what's an example? If I take a gold sheet, okay, this is gold, it's a sheet of gold, and I create holes in this. Okay, these are holes in gold, which are made periodically. And the distance between these holes, okay, is of the order of, say, tens of nanometers or hundreds of nanometers. Right? It's suboptical wavelength. What happens here is that this is much bigger than the angstrom level, right? But this whole arrangement acts like a photonic crystal, because for photons, you see a new kind of a band structure emerging. Okay, because of this periodic arrangement of refractive index. So what you have done here is actually created a crystal or a repeating arrangement of refractive indices. And that is what creates photonic band gaps, and you can use this for waveguides, for lensing. In fact, there is supposed to be using these kind of metamaterials. People are trying to make something called perfect lenses. Okay? And people are trying to make, what is that visible? I mean, if you want to shield something, okay, perfect shielding. It's called invisible cloak, right? Cloaking. It's called cloaking. Place a sheet of metamaterial on something, and you would think that nothing is kept there. Okay? It's as if something was transparent, because it turns out these metamaterials are natural waveguides. Okay? They take the light that is coming in from one direction, and they don't reflect it. They actually channelize it, and leave it on the other end. Which means that the person who is standing on the other end will actually see things which are beyond this particular object. Okay? So it would seem as if that object is not there at all. Okay? So that is possible using these things called metamaterials, which are basically, you know, these refractive index crystals or photonic crystals. Okay, so there are many, many, many different kinds of crystals. Okay, and this was just a short introduction to that. But if you come across any other new kinds of crystals, do let me know. I would be interested to know this. So let's now go into more mundane stuff. What's the time? Yeah, we have time. Okay. Right, so as we have seen, the crystal has a structural unit. Structural unit, which is the repeating unit, could be either monoatomic, okay, or it could be polyatomic. Okay. And then there is something called a Brevi lattice. Now, most of these concepts you would have studied in the first course on solid state physics. So I would not go very deep into it. I'll just review them basically. Brevi lattice, and I introduce a basis. Okay, that gives me crystal structure. So notice that there is a difference between crystal structure and the lattice. Okay, so only when you introduce a basis of atoms into that lattice, you get the full crystal structure. Okay, so what's an example? If I take, for example, NaCl, okay? NaCl is actually FCC structure. We will go into this, right? But the FCC is the Brevi lattice, okay? And the basis is NaCl, right? So it's a diatomic basis, and the Brevi lattice is FCC, right? Okay, so now, what's a Brevi lattice? So it should be the same when you view it from any point R dash and R. Okay? So should appear to be the same when viewed from two points. Points R and R dash, when they are related, R and R dash should be related by a lattice vector. Okay? So this should be any general lattice vector. Right? So and then mathematically I can describe a lattice, okay? A 3D lattice, for example. I can describe it using any three vectors, A1, A2, A3, which are linearly independent. So this is not a surprising feature. This is basically a property of three-dimensional space. So mathematically, if I give you three-dimensional space, and I asked you to describe any point in that, you will need three coordinates, x, y, z, right? Now, x, y, z assumes that you have three orthogonal coordinates, I, j, k, or x, y, z directions, right? And you're taking the projections on each particular axis, x, y, z, and then telling me what is the projection on the x-axis, that is the x-coordinate, what is the projection on y-coordinate, that is the y-axis. But I could choose non-orthogonal coordinate systems also, okay? And if I look at crystal structures, then most crystallines, most crystals may not be, or many crystals may not be orthogonal, may not have orthogonal axes, okay? And they might not even have unit vectors as the lattice parameters. Their lattice parameters could be different in different directions. The angles between the crystal axes may not be 90 degrees at all, right? They could be different than 90 degrees. So depending on what the lattice parameter relations are and what the angles between the axes are, there are several crystal families, okay? But the main point is that you need three linearly independent vectors in three dimensions to describe any point on the lattice, okay? And if you want to describe any arbitrary point on the lattice, you can take any arbitrary linear combination of A1, A2, A3. If you want to describe any lattice point, then you should use only integers to describe, to create a linear combination. So basically N1, N2, N3 are integers, and that will describe a lattice point. So again, I would like to emphasize here, you must remember that lattice point are not the same as ionic positions, right? Because if you have a basis, then it means that somewhere along that basis, you have chosen the lattice to exist. For example, if those of you who know graphene, okay, graphene has a two-atom basis, okay? But you can choose the lattice point to be on one of the carbon atoms or in between the carbon atoms or anywhere along that line. So that would be a lattice point. So a lattice point defines a certain reference point or the origin for the basis. And on that lattice point, you could have a full polyatomic basis which is sitting there, right? And this linear combination of the three vectors only defines the lattice point, not the basis vectors. You would have to define additional basis vectors in order to describe the ionic positions or the crystal positions, okay? Right. So what we can also think of is a concept called the primitive cell or the primitive unit cell. And this is the minimum volume cell. Okay? It's a minimum volume cell defined by A1, A2, A3. So it's a parallelepiped which is defined by A1, A2, A3, these three vectors, and that is the minimum volume cell. And this parallelepiped, if you repeat it in space, you can cover all space. Okay, there is no empty space that is left, right? So that is called the primitive lattice cell. All right, now let's just go back one step. Now, depending on what symmetries a particular lattice structure has, you can do a huge classification, okay? And the symmetry operations that you can do in order to make this classification are, for example, lattice translation, okay? And you can also have point operations. So in terms of point operations, you can have rotation. Rotation, reflection. Okay. So, and then there are compound operations. If you combine these three, you can create compound operations. Okay. So, there is a whole, study of these crystal structures. You can have point groups and the Schoenflies notation, for example, depends on such classification and the symmetries of the system. And the symmetries of the system are also important to study because there are several things like, for example, piezoelectricity centrosymmetry, for example, which determines whether a certain material will be ferroelectric or not. Okay, so symmetries are definitely important in finding out whether a certain material can have a certain behavior or not. Okay, so we will not be going into the full details of these symmetry operations. That forms a subject on its own, and that is what crystallography is basically. Okay, and some part of it is covered in the Chandrabas teaches in group theory and spectroscopy. Course in NCU or CPMU also covers it. I am not sure of that. But if I want to find out the volume of this parallelepiped, so let me go back to the crystal structure or the Bravais lattice, parallelepiped, then that is given by the triple product, A1 dot A2 cross A3, okay, which is also written as A1, A2, A3. So that would give me the volume of the primitive unit cell. Now there is something else in the same context. It's called the Wigner side cell. Okay. And by the way, the choice of A1, A2, A3 is not unique. Okay, which means that the volume of parallelepiped may not be unique. Okay, but it turns out that the volume actually gets preserved even though you choose different. You can choose different lattice vectors, but the volume turns out to be exactly the same. Okay, that's because you want to fill the entire space out of a certain number of repeating units, and the number of repeating units has to be the same because the entire volume is the same. Okay, so even though you may make a different choice of A1, A2, A3, you will end up with the same volume of the parallelepiped. And in the same way, there is something called a Wigner side cell, which is a unique and unambiguous definition of a primitive unit cell. Where what you can do is, there is a certain recipe for preparing a Wigner side cell. So you take neighboring points, okay, and you join, or you take a particular site, okay, and then you join the neighboring points of that particular site, nearest neighbors, okay. Start with nearest neighbors, then go to next nearest neighbors, then go to next nearest neighbors, and so on, okay. So join neighboring points. Once you join neighboring points, then draw perpendicular, okay, bisectors for each of these joiners, for each of these lines which are joining the neighboring points. Once you do that, then you would see that these perpendicular bisects, they intersect at some point. Okay? And when they intersect, that would give you the smallest bounded volume. In 3D or in 2D, it will give you the area. Okay. So one example could be, for example, you can take a square lattice. Square lattice, you can follow this prescription. So what I can do is I can start from here. Let me choose a different color maybe. Not sure if it works. Let me see. Yeah. Okay. I do this. This comes out much better on the board. I'm sorry, this is going all over the place. So I'm actually drawing on the slate, but looking at the screen. Okay. So that's why it's very difficult because I'm not looking at where I'm writing and I can't see what I'm writing unless I see the screen. So it's a little bit of a challenge. So please bear with me. So I draw this perpendicular bisector here, 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 and so on. Okay. Join all of, then you can see the Wigner of Bravais lattice. It's a square lattice, right? It's a normal square lattice. Is principle of the construction cell, right? Now, let's look at something else. How do you define crystal planes? Okay. And the study of crystal planes is important because that is what will lead us to the concept of diffraction, right? Or X-ray diffraction, and how to find the crystal structures themselves. Let me save this. By the way, are all of you there? Are you sleeping? You awake? Any comments?
Fine, sir.
Okay, fine.
I'm not sure. This is like a, by the way, after lunch session is called a graveyard session in conferences. Because most people, after having conference lunch, when they sit for the seminar, they would usually go to sleep. Okay, so I hope that is not happening with you guys. Already crystallography is not a very interesting subject. And I try to make it interesting, but and I hope that you guys are all awake. Let me see. Okay. So we have to define something called index system for or Miller indices. You might, you guys might have studied this concept. And let me try to import one image. Yeah, add image. Oops. Okay, so what you see here in this figure is that there is an x-axis, there is a y-axis, there is a z-axis, and this this point here, the vertices, okay, so what is happening here is that there is a certain crystal plane that has been drawn here, okay. Now on this crystal plane, there would be atoms sitting in certain positions. And what one has done here is that one has taken the intercept of this crystal plane along the three axes, x, y, z axis. And that intercept cuts the x-axis, y-axis, and z-axis at, let's say, 2 times the lattice parameter ax, 3 times the lattice parameter along the y-direction ay, and then 2 times along the az. Okay. So if I write down just the intercepts along the three axes, then they look like 2, 3, 2, okay? So, the but this is not Miller indices, okay? So what one has to do is, the recipe for this is that if you take the intercepts and then write down the reciprocals, okay? So take the reciprocals of this intercepts, then you would get 1/2, 1/3, and 1/2, okay? And now, take the LCM of this, of these three, right? And then multiply the entire set by that, right? So it's basically 6. So if you multiply 6 to this entire set, you will get 3, 2, 3, okay? And this three numbers are called H, K, L. And these are the Miller indices. So notice what we have done. We have taken the crystal plane. We have found out the intercepts along the three axes. Intercepts would have some would be some multiple of the lattice parameter. So write those multiples, okay, and then take the reciprocals of those. And you will see why we are doing this. Okay, later on when we go from real space to reciprocal space, you will see why the reciprocal becomes very important, right? So take the reciprocals of those and then multiply it by a certain integer so that all of them become integers, the smallest co-primes, they become co-prime integers. Okay? So there should not be anything in common. So 3 to 3 is the Miller indices for the plane that is shown in this figure. Okay? So that's important. And then you can also... So let's say if I want to write a plane which is 100, It has Miller indices 100. So tell me, what is this plane? How can I visualize this plane?
It won't intercept the z-axis and nor the y-axis. It will be
y and z-axis. That's what you said, right? It will not intersect the y and z-axis. It will intersect the x-axis.
Yes.
At one.
Yes.
Okay. So how do you infer this? Can you explain?
I can draw a plane which will be parallel to yz plane. And it will be at x equal to 1.
So what are its intercepts?
Its intercepts are 1, infinity and infinity.
Excellent. So it's 1, infinity, comma infinity. And then if I take the reciprocals of this, I get 1, 0, 0.
Yes.
Exactly. So if I take a crystal plane which is parallel to the yz plane, right, but cuts the x-axis at x is equal to 1, then its intercepts along the y and z axis are basically infinity and infinity, which gives me the Miller indices 100. So 100 is a plane which is parallel to the yz plane. Now similarly, I can write a plane which is 200, right? But then 200, 300 or 1 bar 00 is basically -1, 0, 0. So all of this are families of the same plane. It's a family of planes which is in the same class. They're all parallel to the yz plane, right? So if I want to write a family of planes, then the conventional notation is to use this, a curly bracket. Okay, a round bracket is for a single plane and a curly bracket is for a whole family of planes. Okay. Now if I want to denote any crystal direction, then a crystal direction can be denoted as R is equal to M1A1 plus M2A2 plus M3A3. Now here you see again there are three integers, M1, M2, M3, right? So this is denoted by square brackets. Okay? So the square brackets basically denote a crystal direction. It is for a family of crystal planes. And round brackets is for a single plane Miller indices, right? So that's just the notation part. And this tells you how to denote the Miller indices. Now this is a convention, and it turns out that this convention is most useful for understanding crystallography. Okay? So that's why people do this rather than doing directly the real space intercepts. That turns out to be not so useful. Okay? So let's save this and move forward. Yeah, let's go into some examples of crystal structures. So just reminding you, this is all just a review of your basic solid state physics crystal structures. Okay, it's not going. Right. Okay, so let's look at some simple crystal structures. Let's look at sodium chloride. Okay, so let me import a certain image into this. Okay, I don't know how to make this bigger, but okay, I'm sorry, I don't know how to make this bigger or how to move this. I'm also in the learning phase of this, but basically the green atoms that you see are sodium and the black ones are the sodium and the green is chlorine. And what you can see here is that if you just focus on the green atoms, then the green atoms basically form an FCC structure, a face-centered cubic. So you can see there is a face here, and this green atom is sitting at the center of this face. Similarly, if you take this particular face, then this green atom is sitting at this center of this face, right? So the green atoms are forming an FCC structure. Okay, so the Brauer lattice of the sodium chloride crystal structure is a FCC lattice, but the FCC is not the crystal structure. Okay, to get the crystal structure, you have to take the FCC Brauer lattice. Okay, so it's a FCC Brauer lattice, and you have to add a basis. And the basis that you can see here is that there is a chlorine atoms are also forming their own FCC structure, right? So you can pair up one of the sodium and one of the chlorines and call that a certain basis. And with that basis, now you can see that there is a FCC Brauer lattice. Okay? So, and you can say that the basis is basically one sodium atom. And one, so this is the basis, is one sodium atom and one chlorine atom is separated by 1/2 or half of the body diagonal cube. So that's basically the basis, and if you incorporate the basis into the Brauer lattice, you get the sodium chloride structure. Okay. Similarly, there is a cesium chloride, and cesium chloride is BCC, okay. So which means that the cesium atoms, they form a body-centered cubic structure, and the chlorine atoms also form a body-centered cubic structure. But then if you consider one cesium and one chlorine atom, then the Brauer lattice is BCC. Okay, so this is all a cubic system, but then there are more complicated cubic systems. Let me come to that.
Sir, as I learned, cesium chloride is called a primitive cubic structure because the corners, if corners are occupied by chlorine, let's say, then the body centered position is occupied by cesium, which has completely different scattering factor. So the symmetry of this represents the symmetry of a primitive cube, but not a body centered cube.
Let me just bring that image. I'll show you that image. 1 minute. Okay, so now if we see this, you're right, it's actually just a cubic structure. So the cesium and the chlorines, they basically form independent, correct, it's interpenetrating cubes. It's a simple cubic structure, you're right. It's not BCC.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, I don't know why I said BCC. You're absolutely right. This is a simple cubic structure, but interpenetrating cubic structure, simple cubic structure. Yeah. Now, let me bring in diamond structure. So diamond also, most of you would know that it's a interpenetrating FCC structure, right? So there is tetrahedral bonding. I will repair this lecture later, okay, but this image is, I'm not able to move images easily within this software. I'm using something called a sketchbook, and it's not easy to move images, although it's easy to import them. So basically what you see here is that all of these are carbon atoms. This is diamond, okay. So you can write this, this is a diamond, and it's a interpenetrating FCC. So, by the way, for reading up on all this, take a look at Kittel's first chapter. Okay, so that's what we would be mostly following. Then Kittel has explained things very nicely. In fact, the assignments will also be based on Kittel's first chapter. Okay, so do go through Kittel. I've probably forgotten to mention that in the list of references, or maybe I have. I don't remember exactly. Okay, so we know that diamond has tetrahedral bonding of carbon atoms, but that can be reconciled with the crystal structure by saying that there, the one set of carbon atoms forms an FCC, and if you displace, if you go along the body diagonal, 1/4, 1/4, 1/4, then the carbon atom that you see would be the starting point of another FCC structure. Okay, so there are two interpenetrating FCC lattices which are displaced from each other on 1/4 of the body diagonal. Okay, and through this you can also explain the tetrahedral bonding. Okay, so that's diamond structure, and then zinc blend is also similar to diamond, except that here the carbon and carbon are the same along the body diagonal, but in the zinc blend structure you would get A atom on one of the vertices and in the basis, and B atom on the other basis site. Okay, so that is the zinc blend structure. All right, so now what we'll do is, next time we will go into the details of the reciprocal lattice, okay, and how is it related to the real space lattice, and why is the reciprocal lattice so important, okay, or why is the reciprocal lattice, you know, how does it determine, for example, the band structure, how does it determine the phonon properties, all kinds of properties are determined. In fact, the X-ray diffraction of the reciprocal lattice, not of the real space lattice. So let me, yeah, okay. So yeah, this brings me to the end of this lecture, and if you have any questions now, you can ask, or if no questions, then let's all have a coffee. Any questions?
Sir, I have one.
Yeah.
So, means apart from energy minima, so is there any other factor which determines the any constant, like any matter or something?
See, the basically a crystal is a ground state of a certain collection of atoms and molecules, right? And when we talk of a ground state, then it has to be the global minimum structure.
Okay.
You could force things into different structures, let's say with very high pressure and so on. But under those conditions, that would turn out to be the lowest possible energy structure. Now, there are systems where the arrangement is not really a global minimum, but could be a local minimum also. Simply because, let's say, you are driving the system, okay? Mm-hmm. And when you're driving the system, let's say you are heating it or cooling it, and you could do a non-equilibrium transition where the system has gone into a metastable state. Okay, because you're driving the system so rapidly, you have not given the system enough time to equilibrate. And in that case, what happens is that the system stabilizes, okay, in a metastable way, into a crystal structure which is not the global minimum. Okay, so that is also a possibility. But in general, if you give the system enough time, right, then the system would always go into a global minimum structure of energy. So I do not know of any other conditions under equilibrium where, which would give rise to the formation of a crystal structure, which would lead to a particular crystal structure.
Okay, yeah, thank you.
Sir, I have a question.
Yes.
Whenever there is continuous symmetry breaking in a system, mm-hmm. then Nambu-Goldstone modes will arise.
That's right.
When I am going from, say, a liquid state to solid state, mm-hmm. then continuous translational symmetry as well as rotational symmetry is broken.
That's right.
And there are some acoustic and optical phonon modes in the solid system. Correct. So I want to know which symmetry is responsible for the the emergence of phonon
which
modes.
Kinds of phonons? Yeah.
Exactly. So, which one will be responsible for what?
So the thing is, it's a well debated subject, and there is no one-to-one correspondence regarding the breaking of particular symmetries to the particular polarization of phonons. Okay. Known is that once you break the continuous symmetry, you have to have long wavelength or zero energy modes, right? So all the acoustic modes, acoustic phonon modes, whether they are longitudinal or transverse, they are a result of translational and rotational symmetry breaking. But it's still not known how to make a one-to-one correspondence. Let's say you have a certain polarization, acoustic phonon mode, or a transverse phonon mode, right? Then you cannot really say that, okay, this particular directional symmetry, let's say X direction symmetry you have broken, but this, okay? So that one-to-one correspondence has still not been identified.
Okay, sir.
Yeah.
And is there any particular reason for having, because there is no symmetry breaking when we are going from gas phase to liquid phase?
Mm-hmm. So the liquid also seems to have certain normal modes, but they are, but because the liquid is always moving, it turns out that there are no steady or no stationary modes. Okay. So, but liquid also has vibrational modes, and especially when you take liquids which are close to jamming conditions, jamming conditions would mean that the liquid is almost going to be a crystal, or it's almost going to be localized, right? Then you can have normal modes in a liquid as well. And this is a subject that Shrikant Shastri studies very well. But are you asking what kind of symmetries are broken when you go
yes.
from a gas to a
yes.
liquid?
Yes, sir.
So a liquid does have a short range order. It turns out that if you go to a liquid gas transition and you're very close to the liquid gas transition, then you might not be able to identify the short range order. But it turns out that if you are slightly deeper into the liquid phase, then you will be able to detect short range order, okay, in the liquid, which is not detectable in the gaseous phase. Right. So because you have short range order in a liquid, it means that you are breaking some symmetries, but those symmetries are not broken over a continuous interval of time. Okay. And which is why these normal modes that appear are not stationary. Okay. So it's a very complicated subject, right? Because you can see that a liquid is always in motion. It's not a stationary object, which is why the normal modes are not stationary. And the order is also not long range as well as it is dynamic. It's a dynamic short range order. And that's why it becomes very complicated. But indeed, one can find short range order. Okay. And this is again something that people who study liquid gas transitions, for example, Mehboob Alam also studies these kind of things. Shrikant Shastri studies these kind of things. I think probably Balasubramaniam also studies these kind of things in ionic liquids.
Okay.
Okay, so if there are no more questions, let's end this, and we'll meet tomorrow at 4. Okay, bye.
Bye.
Thank you, sir.